So how can you stand out as a student developer? Now, this is a question I get asked all the time. So what I'm doing in this video is a collaboration with an ex-Google, ex-Facebook engineer who actually was in charge of kind of the hiring process and looking for new interns and looking for full-time employees. And we're going to be talking with him about what makes you stand out. What can you put on your resume that really, you know, gets you that job interview? Or what can you say during an interview that's going to secure you that job? So anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed. The person that I brought on here is Clement. He has an awesome YouTube channel. I don't think he got a chance to talk about it a ton in the video, but really, it has some great resources on there, and I'd really recommend that you guys go over there, subscribe to his channel, and check it out. Anyways, with that being said, let's talk about what makes a student developer stand out and get into the video. Okay, guys, so I'm here with Clem. We're gonna start talking about what makes a good student developer, how to stand out as a student developer. I just wanna give him a chance to introduce himself in case any of you guys haven't seen his YouTube channel or don't know kind of who he is and what he does. So Clem, what do you wanna tell the audience?
Yeah, thanks for having me, first of all, Tim. This is the second video that we're doing together. I'm really excited about it. My name is Clement. I am a software engineer and entrepreneur. I know that's a weird title to give yourself, but effectively at this point, that's what I am. I worked at Google and Facebook over the past two and a half years or so. Now I'm working full-time on my company, AlgoExpert, AlgoExpert.io. We help people like you, the audience, prepare for coding interviews like the ones at Google and Facebook. And I have this YouTube channel where I talk about all things related to software engineering, entrepreneurship, and everything in between.
Awesome. Yeah. So Clem, you know, thanks for coming on here. If you guys haven't seen, I did a live coding interview with him actually on his channel. It was kind of a mock student intern coding video. And that one, you know, went really well. So guys, go check that out. But to prepare for that video, I used AlgoExpert, and genuinely, I think it's a great tool for all the tools, like even LeetCode, some of the other ones I've used. It's my favorite. If you guys do want to purchase that, I do have a 15% discount code, so you can check that out. Link in the description. The discount code is TechWithTim. Anyways, let's get into it. So I just want to start by asking you a little bit about your background, because I know that you're actually not like a computer science major, software engineering major. I think you were a math major, right? Do you want to talk about how you even maybe kind of got into software engineering a little bit? What, you know, started your kind of journey from, you know, having a math major?
Sure. I'll give you the very brief pitch. I've said this many places, but throughout college, I had no idea what I wanted to do. The only sort of guiding light that I had was that I was interested in entrepreneurship. I wanted to build my own company one day. I did not have the technical skills to do that. And so throughout college, I tried a bunch of different things. The tiny bit that I dabbled with programming, I hated. I didn't like CSS, HTML, that kind of stuff. I ended up doing math my senior year. I like stuffed a math major in about a year and a summer just because it felt like a potentially good, you know, major on paper. But after college, I said, okay, maybe I need to know how to code. And I went to a coding boot camp for 3 months right after school. Loved software engineering, loved coding. And then I got into Google, and the rest is sort of history. But that's my college story in a nutshell.
Wow. Okay. So, I mean, starting right there, you know, this tells you, you don't need a computer science degree or software engineering degree to get into one of these large companies, right? I mean, like, we have living proof right here in front of us. So, I mean, that's kind of going to lead me into this question, which most people are going to know the answer to, but I think it's important to talk about. You know, do you need to be like a really good student to get into one of these companies? Now, I know it's a little bit different than like your degree and stuff, but do you need to have like stupid high marks to be able to get into Google or get into Microsoft or any of these large tech companies? Or is it okay if you have, you know, some other parts of your resume that really complement that? Like, how important really is the GPA?
Yeah, and so here, I think this is one of those questions, like you implied, most people think they probably know the answer, but it always helps to get, you know, reaffirmation of it. No, you don't need only high marks, or high marks or high grades are not going to be the only thing that gets you through the door. Certainly not the thing that breaks you, you know, prevents you from getting through the door. If you have good grades, fantastic. It's obviously an extra data point. You know, if you have a 4.0 GPA in an American university, for instance, then yes, that is an indicator that you are at least capable in certain respects. But if you don't have a great GPA and you have other things, you can still be great. If anything, I would say the GPA is great, but not sufficient. The GPA is great, but not sufficient. In fact, I would argue that anybody can have a good GPA. There are a lot of people who have, you know, 3.7 plus GPAs. However, there aren't that many people who have really unique, really cool projects or really unique, really cool stories. So don't worry too much about the GPA. Don't over-index on the GPA.
Okay, so I think that's great advice. And if you guys want some more information about projects specifically, because you just mentioned that being, you know, one of the important factors to even being considered at one of these companies, we actually made a video talking specifically about programming projects. So I'll leave a card or a link to that in the description that you guys can check out. But anyways, this kind of leads nicely into the next question then is, what is, you know, that one kind of extracurricular activity or one thing that you see that really stands out, right? Like, what are people doing outside of school that to you, when you look at it, you're like, this is really impressive. You know, we need to give this person an interview. Or what's that kind of, those things on the resume that really pop out that people should be working on as students to stand out, right?
Yeah. And so here it's really like, first of all, it depends. It's one of those things where unfortunately there isn't an exact answer. You know, if you're looking for that magic formula, it's not there. It doesn't exist. But I would take a step back and try to really ask yourself, you know, what are you trying to accomplish when you're applying to a job or trying to, you know, give your resume to a company or a recruiter? You're trying to demonstrate that they should take a shot on you, that you are a capable individual, right? And if you imagine that these people are getting hundreds, if not thousands, multiple thousands, tens of thousands of the same kinds of applicants, you want to stand out. So how do you stand out? By doing something that is as unique as possible. Like we just said, the GPA is great, it's not unique. Software engineering projects are great, and that's where you can make them unique. That's where you can stand out. But if you go with just, you know, if you take just a cookie cutter software engineering project, that's not necessarily going to be unique. So the goal that you have to do, the task that I'm charging you with, the audience, is to find a way to make yourself unique, whether that be with a combination of cool projects, with some other extracurricular, like as an example, maybe you are someone who not only is great at computer science and you have cool projects, but you're also a really good debater. And you've found a way to mix your hobby of debating with your hobby in, or your, you know, your interest in computer science. That right there is something pretty unique, you know. Or take Tim that we're doing the video with. Tim, we're on Tim's channel here. I don't need to say who Tim is, but Tim immediately stands out as unique because of his YouTube channel. Like, granted, I realize that some of you are going to be like, well, we're not all like Tim, like we don't all have, you know, 140k subscribers, but you can find a way to do something that's unique. You don't need 140k subscribers, okay? You don't need to be at that level of like, whoa, that's so legit. But just something that makes you look unique, that shows that you're passionate, curious, so on and so forth.
Awesome. Okay, so I think that was a really great answer. I think that shows you guys, right, that, you know, you need to be doing things that are going to show that you're passionate, but also stand out. So, you know, I made that resume project video to discuss two projects that you can kind of whip up in a weekend, but don't just take those, right? Find something that you think is really interesting and that, you know, you want to work on and you want to do that's unique, that you know, doesn't exist out there already. And that is going to make you stand out, just like Clemson saying. Okay, so I mean, this next question, I mean, we've kind of already touched on it. These all kind of mesh together in some way. How relevant is your degree to being a great developer? And if you don't have a degree like you, right, what should you really be focusing on maybe while you're in school or right when you get out and you're looking for a job to kind of show that you know what you're doing? So we talked about the programming projects, but maybe there's like some specific skills that you might not have if you're not in a computer science degree. Maybe you can give me some like examples of those skills that you should really, you know, hone in and focus in on if you're trying to get in and you don't have, you know, a degree or a background in that area, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, totally. So first of all, and this enters kind of a contentious topic on, you know, are college degrees worth it? Then some people are going to immediately discredit whatever I say because they're going to say, well, he has, you know, an Ivy League math degree, which is a fair point. You know, it's a fair point. But I think that we are entering an era, and I'm not trying to sound, you know, epic or badass, but seriously, we're entering an era where college degrees are becoming less and less worth it. You have a lot of companies that are increasingly no longer requiring college degrees. Google is one of them. Google literally no longer, like officially, does not require a college degree anymore. That's not to say that a college degree doesn't help you. It probably helps you a little bit, but it is no longer necessary. You have things like coding boot camps. I'm a firm believer in coding boot camps since I went to a coding boot camp and it clearly paid off for me. So I would say that your degree is not the most important thing. If you went to Harvard, fantastic. If you didn't go to Harvard, you can still be at that same level. You can still be just as outstanding or just as unique. You know, you just have to build your story. I would say that, you know, if you can complement your knowledge of computer science, whether that was acquired through a college degree, a boot camp, self-taught, whatever, and you've demonstrated it through software engineering projects, if you can complement your software engineering skills with some of the softer skills of software engineering that people don't necessarily associate with software engineering, but that are crucial to software engineering, things like being a great communicator, being Well, to be honest, I would say communication is like that one big umbrella thing, and there are a bunch of things that fall into it. But so, as an example, maybe you really love writing, and maybe you are really good at writing, and you want to pursue, for instance, a degree in English, as an example, but you are also teaching yourself coding on the side. Maybe you've done a coding boot camp, and you are, by all accounts and measures, you know, a software engineer. And that's going to go really cool, and that will make you unique, actually. You're going to be that person who's a fantastic writer, but also a great software engineer. Maybe you were really interested in finance. Go do a finance degree, or, you know, go study finance, and use that awesome complementary knowledge with your software engineering skills to make you stand out, and so on and so forth. So hopefully that answers your question and gives you an idea of how you can be, like, creative. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. And I think you touched on a great point, which is that a lot of people look at the degree they have as a disadvantage. They're like, well, you know, I have this English degree and I really want to be computer science. Like, this isn't going to do anything for me. But if you can prove in other ways that you're a great developer, that degree is a massive advantage, I think, to you. And I think you touched on that really well. You're saying, you know, look, not only am I a great developer, but I have this English degree. I'm well-versed in these two different areas, and that's something that you're not going to get, and that's going to make you stand out. And that's the whole point of this video, is to understand how you can kind of tailor your skills and what you're focusing on to stand out, right, at these companies and get a job. So that was a great answer. I think that put some great insight into it. Yeah, I would say, you know, maybe what is one of those skills that you notice is really lacking? What, maybe when someone comes in for an interview, or, you know, an intern, or some younger employees with less experience, what are the skills that you wish, you know, they had better, or that they had improved? What should they really focus on? If you're getting kind of what I'm saying by that.
Yeah. Totally. I would say that the number one skill that I visibly see as lacking, and that sometimes is not lacking, and that makes them stand out in certain candidates, but especially in the younger ones, the college grads, for instance, is that communication, especially the verbal communication. Because in an interview, I typically will not see your written communication. I'll see it after on the job when you're writing design docs or emails or whatever. But that verbal communication, I would say, if you can practice your verbal communication, go take a public speaking class, go in a public speaking club, go do some form of public speaking, presentations in your classes or whatever, that is going to get you a long way. Communication is critical in interviews. It's critical on the job. It'll make you stand out, because you will be unique in that sense. And also, tied with communication, this is an even softer skill, but I would say confidence. And I know that this is a tough one, because it's like, it's very hard to build up confidence. Confidence is a very unique skill in and of itself. But I remember one person, a new grad that I interviewed at Google, and not only was he brilliant in the interview, did great on the algorithm, great on the coding and all that, but he exuded a confidence, and it came with good communication skills. He exuded a confidence, not arrogance, confidence, where I was like, okay, this person seems like very mature, seems like a great potential coworker, and he does it great. So that would be another thing that I would say to, if you can, you know, work on it, and that comes with public speaking and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I think that's great. And I mean, to go with confidence, like what you were talking about there, I think that's important in every aspect of life in general.
Yeah.
And you know, how are you going to believe that this person knows what they're doing if they don't believe it themselves, right? And that's what I tell myself whenever I'm, you know, giving a presentation or talking, even making a YouTube video. How are you guys going to believe that I know what I'm talking about if I don't believe it myself? And that's where the confidence comes in, right? You're talking, you showing that you really do understand it. And I think that's what you're saying. It really makes you stand out, because it's hard to gain that, and a lot of people don't have that skill. And one last thing, because I think you missed maybe one point that's really good. If you guys want to practice like your speaking and your confidence, film yourself. You see what I'm doing with this YouTube channel? Go watch the first video I ever made and tell me if I'm more confident then or if I'm more confident now.
Yep.
And just like the level of communication skills, right? That's a really great way. And that's one of the reasons I love doing YouTube, is because every time I do it, I can become more articulate. I can become a better communicator. I can learn, you know, how to talk with other people, how to, you know, show information in ways that make sense. And that's a really great thing. And I'm not saying everyone needs to have a YouTube channel, but if you want to film yourself, or you want to just have like a really small channel, maybe a portfolio, or even just watch, you know, your video when you're filming yourself back, that's going to help you a ton. I think you'd agree with that, right?
Agreed. Yeah. And like you said, it's not necessarily the only way, but it is one way.
I think with that, I mean, is there anything else you want to say that really, you know, helps someone stand out? I'll give you one, like, kind of wrap up the interview that we have here.
Yeah, I mean, I'll reiterate the point that you made about embracing your degree, even if it's not a computer science degree. I would go as far as to say that you might be better off if you don't have a computer science degree, so long as you are playing your cards correctly and gaining those comp sci computer science skills elsewhere. But you might be better off because you'll be more skilled in other aspects of life. And then the last thing that I'll say is just, no matter where you are in life right now, you might have made mistakes. Maybe you feel like you've wasted your first 2 years, your first 4 years of college. No matter where you are, you can spin things around and make the best of it. So if you're feeling down and you feel like you're not as impressive as somebody else, realize that you can't change the past. You can only go forward and try to make the best of it. Try to make yourself stand out by moving forward and doing the best that you can.
Awesome. I think that's a great point that everyone should consider for literally any profession, whether it's going to be computer science or not. And I just want to thank you again, Clement, for coming on. I think these videos that we've made have been really valuable and given a lot of people some great insight. You guys are enjoying these kind of videos and you want more like this, definitely hit the like button. Leave a comment down below and let us know, because I think, you know, I can't speak for Clem, but we'd be more than open to do, you know, some more videos like this that really give some deep insight into different areas of kind of getting a job and just presenting yourself, you know, properly in a like a professional workplace, right?
Definitely.
So yeah, with that being said, if you guys enjoyed, as always, leave a like, subscribe, and I will see you guys in another video.